entrepreneur Leerom Segal launched his first business at age 12. I don't know why he waited so long. He sold his first company at 14, became the CTO of a publicly traded company before his 16th birthday, and he co-founded Klick at 17. Today, the Klick group of companies includes Klick Health, the world's largest independent commercialization partner in life sciences. It's really, on behalf of the Convergence team, it's really a pleasure and an honor to welcome here today. I will stop sharing, and I'm glad to turn over the mic.
Thank you so much for the kind words. And hello, everyone. It's wonderful to be here with so many young and enterprising minds at this progressing forum, connecting future entrepreneurs and leaders globally. We were asked to share the Klick Genesis story, so we thought we'd start from the very beginning and just put a few images on the screen. But the story really began when we first moved to Canada. Well, one of the things that we realized very quickly is if money doesn't buy you happiness, poverty sure as hell doesn't. And as kids, we did the things that, you know, kids can do. We started organizing friends to, you know, shovel lawns or mow lawns and shovel driveways. And eventually we realized that the one place where little kids could have a little bit of respect was in technology. And that really led us to becoming really passionate about technology and starting to really assemble computer parts, kind of doing what Dell was doing in the US here in Canada. And it also connected us. And this was a really lucky break. At age 12, we connected with Peter Cordy. Peter Cordy and Aaron Goldstein are the two co-founders of Klick, but Peter is a lot older than us today. He's in his late 70s. But at the time, he ran a really progressive interactive agency, and he gave us a break. We were able to build an incredible relationship, and we were able to learn a lot. Peter's really acted like a mentor and almost like a second father to us, and that was an incredible gift. And what that allowed us to do over the years is really build Klick into an ecosystem of companies that help life sciences commercialize. So what does that mean in English? Today, what we do is we help life sciences brands to launch medicines into market. And we would get involved with these companies in their later stages of clinical trials. We would help with tactical things like recruiting for those clinical trials, but we would also help them with sizing and shaping the market. As you can imagine, especially in the United States, access is a really important issue. So sometimes that's a policy or advocacy issue. Sometimes that's a strategy issue. So a lot of advisory services around pricing and things like that. And very often there's a managed markets component, but also a real brand component. And one of the things that makes life sciences a little bit harder to communicate and market within is that it's a highly regulated space. So whether we're talking to patients or caregivers or healthcare professionals or payers or any one of the many other stakeholders, the regulations are probably different. But yet there's a lot of common threads. You need one medical strategy, one narrative that works for all of these audiences. That requires a lot of insights. That requires a lot of brand planning. And then how you pull that through across all channels, from how you develop the audience, what you drive them to, and how you keep that conversation going after it converts. That's really some of the core capabilities of Klick. And the way we're differentiated is on the decision sciences layer that underpins that. I'm going to play a quick video for everyone to give you a little bit of a flavor for the energy of Klick. And then we'll walk into some of the lessons that we've learned on this journey.
20 years ago, a small, independent startup with big dreams called Klick was born. We set out with a bold vision and a people-first philosophy, a quest to build a center of gravity for amazing talent. We've cultivated a culture that is empathetic and puts our people first. When our people are happy, our clients benefit too, because a happy team reciprocates the trust that our clients place in us when they bet their careers on choosing us. And when our clients are happy, they reward us with the loyalty that fuels our growth and in turn, our ability to continue investing in this virtuous cycle. Since our humble beginnings, we have relied on creativity to break through false barriers. Starting from first principles, we take things apart, we critically think, and we challenge conventions. Always staying true to our hacker roots, we continue to passionately pursue our relentless evolution so that we can inoculate ourselves against the status quo. We've always recognized that profit is our fuel, but we also recognize that in the long term, our interests and those of our clients are always aligned. So we prevent short-term thinking from clouding our ability to keep our eye on the prize. And we're always confident enough to tell it like it is. We've even become comfortable collecting the necessary battle scars on the journey to truly disruptive ideas. Yes, the future is fickle. It's fraught with challenges, unforeseen hurdles, and countless obstacles. But we've been conspiring with the future for so long that we've got the grit and resolve to be brave and to achieve truly awesome work and outstanding outcomes. 20 years later, we're proudly 700 people strong, working around the world and bringing together the leading minds to shape the future of healthcare. We have evolved from a technology firm to a thriving marketing agency, and we are now boldly expanding into all facets of life sciences commercialization. We've even earned the privilege to own some of tomorrow's biggest health opportunities. We are Klick, and we dare impossible to stop us.
The modern world is a great place for people like us. It's the most exciting time to be alive in history. There are more changes going on. Crowds are more diverse, including this one. And it's a thrilling time to be alive. Lee stood up on his stage and said, "I was a disruptor." Did you ever think that would become a popular word? And if you look at Klick, Klick is successful because it gets all of you. Bottom line is this: what you're doing will shape the future. You are making the future. Keep the world in the future business.
Klick in one word? Dynamic.
Klick in one word? Ballin'.
Klick in one word? Epic. Empathetic.
Creative.
Diverse.
Ambitious.
Caring.
Cool.
Family.
Growth.
Homegrown.
Tenacious.
Thinking.
I'm eating cookies.
Culturific.
Innovative.
Loyal.
Awesome.
Groovy.
Singular.
Brave.
Leveling up.
Home.
We are Klick, and we dare impossible to stop us.
So hopefully that gives a little bit of context, but I do want to highlight companies at their core are ultimately simply a collection of people and principles. So for that reason, wanted to share our model to show how we bring culture to life at Klick, and then share a few of the lessons that we've learned along the way. In terms of our model itself, it's really comprised of two things. The first is our belief system, and the second is our operating system. Our belief system itself, if we zoom into it, really has two bedrocks. And the first is our core principles. In the interest of time, you can see them on our website if you'd like. But the easiest way to think about these is that this provides a decision framework for our leaders and our team members to be able to make even difficult decisions really quickly. And so for us, that's really about putting people first. It's about our hacker roots. It's about our entrepreneurial spirit and reminding people that we play the long game and we want to focus on outcomes even over optics. The second part of our belief system is really our cultural behavior pyramid. And probably the easiest way to think about this is these are our expectations for how we behave when we're interacting with each other, but also for how we behave when we're interacting with our clients or any broader stakeholders. And I'll explain the structure without going into all the specifics, just in the interest of time. But at the base, what you're seeing is that essence and character. And these are things that are so core to one's personality that we're looking for people that already exhibit these. And so we look for individuals that are optimistic. And when I say that, I always want to highlight that, you know, what we're thinking about here is not people that are just Shooter McGavins giving each other high fives and blowing the sunshine treatment at each other, but people that are truly optimistic about what's possible now that maybe wasn't possible a few years ago, and energized and curious enough to learn how to make that happen. And, you know, obviously people need to be able to balance that drive and empathy, but we also really look for people that are kind and inclusive. And these are things that are just core to one's character. When you move one level up and you look at the Klick way, this is really where we start to invest a lot in education. And you can almost think of every single one of these behaviors as universal expectations. And those universal expectations come with curriculum. So we would teach somebody how to build camaraderie. We would teach somebody how to instrument and experiment and have a bias for action so that we get more learning. We would teach them how to practice radical candor and so on. And then we have a promotion readiness process that teaches people how to become a leader if they're an individual contributor right now, or if they're already a leader of a team and they're already demonstrating that they can inspire confidence and be brave and think exponentially, then they might be working on moving from leading a team to being a leader of leaders. And of course, the standards elevate yet again. And that's where we would be teaching people really how to develop confidence in their teams or how to facilitate in a way that creates calmness and clarity. And that's really it. That's the simplicity of the entire belief system. What's a lot harder to do is at scale to operationalize that. And for that, we've really created four universal standards. And just to highlight what we mean by that, these are really the four parts of our culture that we think are just so important to get right, that instead of allowing the mass improvisation and adaptability that Klick is known for, we've actually created these universal standards. You can call that bureaucracy, you can call it process, but there is one way of doing things when it relates to our people practices. And that's because the quest that we've been on for the last 24 years is in really trying to figure out how do you build a center of gravity for brilliant people. And it's easy to say that, but it's actually really, really hard to bring that to life. And what you're seeing on the screen are the many teams. Each one of these is a team of people that today support the 1,500 Clicksters that are part of our family. Similarly, when it comes to technology, what we're really looking for as a company is we're trying to find these unfair advantages for our team, ways where technology can help us provide more scalability or predictability or consistency. And generally, that's through the use of the creative applications of data and tech. We also do a lot to invest in making sure that we stay modern. And a big part of that is looking at the various ways in which we incubate new offerings and services, but also how we evolve the crafts that we already have. And we're very disciplined about not just building these capabilities, but also investing in cross-pollinating that across the organization. And really the last pillar is how we think about growth. And this is probably the most differentiated from traditional organization or org design and what you might have learned in school. For us, we want to continue to scale up because of some of the advantages that creates, but we never want our teams to get beyond 150 people. So each one of the client success teams is almost like an organization within Klick, and that team would have its own leadership representing every single craft. And within that team, we would always be incubating a business readiness team so that success is actually when the cells divide. And what that really allows us to do is build more of an ecosystem, which is a very flat organization. And we don't end up with these really big silos. And that's really the four pillars of the organization. To show you how that comes to life and how we communicate internally, we've got this couple of minutes video from the town hall that we just did at the end of 2020. This was delivered this past December.
How How awesome is this? Welcome, welcome, welcome. We want to begin by first saying a huge and heartfelt thank you.
2020, what a year.
If I were asked to describe our partnership with Klick, I would use one word, which is inspiring. Klick really got it from the start.
I don't think I've ever worked with an agency that had become so much of the fabric of our effort.
When this year started, none of us knew the pandemic was coming, but our planning at Klick is always done in pencil.
We've all felt that it was so super important to have everyone on the same page from the very beginning.
Our people, culture, and independence are always highlighted, but we have other strengths.
That tickles me.
We filter ideas on a key criteria.
More help is on the way for our frontline healthcare workers, courtesy of a Toronto-based company who's donating 300,000 N95 masks to local hospitals.
Klick Health has donated over 300,000 masks to hospitals and healthcare facilities in the Greater Toronto Area.
You must feel great that you're manufacturing these, the states now wants them as well, and you're doing it because you care. Nobody's making money off of this.
Innovation at One Toronto Company is helping to keep employees happy and safe.
Instead of people going to a flu shot clinic, they're bringing the clinic to staff.
A flu shot brought right to your front door. Abby Matt, a copywriter for Klick Health, got her flu vaccine at home this morning.
At Klick, we've continued to see tremendous growth as an organization.
We are able to leverage each other's strengths.
And we work very synergistically in terms of making it all happen.
Thank you for your partnership. Thank you for your dedication. And thank you for making a difference.
So we want to end where we began, with a huge amount of gratitude.
Thank you so much.
So how did we get here? What we thought we would do is we wanted to share three mantras that have been really valuable for us since inception. We believe that these are really universal, and so hopefully they can serve you as well. And the first one is the relentless pursuit of awesome. Now, if we were a little bit older when we wrote that, maybe we wouldn't have used the word awesome, but the gist of it still holds very true today. And this is really at its core about always inoculating yourself against that status quo. That means thinking of yourself as always being in beta and thinking of your organization as always being in beta, and then loving every opportunity for change, challenge, learning, and doing so in a way that allows you to critically think and take things apart and go from first principles, which at its core is about not blindly following. So if you were to sort of think about that in the form of a hack, you could always ask yourself questions like, why are things this way? And what's possible now? You'd find that in management, so much of the dogma and technology of management is a technology, traces its roots back to the time in the turn of the last century when we were turning from an agrarian society to an industrial society. And some of those things still make sense, but some things like annual planning being done because of the harvest season, that's probably not that relevant to a technology company today. The second thing that we think is a really important thing to think about is focusing on your own competitiveness. People can get really distracted by competition, and they can spend a lot of time catching up to a point in time of where the competition was, not where they're going. And this might sound trite, but from from the management literature point of view, you think you're in the military and that everything has to be command and control. And there's this inherent assumption that business is a zero-sum game, when in fact, what we found is that technologically unlocks an abundance of opportunities for everybody to succeed. And you'll also like yourself more if you recognize that you're only in competition with yourself and your capabilities. The last mantra is really around exponential thinking, and it's really vital in today's world. The world's most disruptive organizations are all benefiting from things like platform theory, exponential technologies. They've got more modern business models. Many of them are on demand. Many of them benefit from crowd and other network effects, or in some cases, all of the above. But it's very important to understand how to harness these forces and how to think about these winning patterns that we're seeing in this new generation of companies. And likewise, when it comes to execution in an exponential world, it's important to recognize that the difference between 90% and 110% is no longer 20%. It's more than 200%, and it compounds. So manage your expectations and be accountable for your commitment, because if you regularly over-deliver in your career, the number of opportunities that will present themselves will also multiply exponentially. We've also benefited from having some wonderful mentors and advice over the years. And we wanted to share with you some of the things that have helped us the most, and hopefully they can help you on the journey. My friend Michael always says that pessimists, they look smart, but optimists get consistently lucky. And it rings incredibly true. It's so easy to look smart by being cynical, yet have you ever noticed how certain people are like psychic vampires in meetings? Nobody wants to spend time with those individuals. And therefore, regardless of their intelligence, they're a lot less likely to succeed in a world that is so intensely connected and multidisciplinary. The thing that Einstein famously said was that you can't solve today's problems with the same thinking that created them. And Dan Sullivan, who regularly coaches me and he's written a lot of great books, talks about thinking about your thinking, which is a very powerful way to reflect, especially after a meeting where maybe you didn't show up the way you wanted to. And it's especially relevant if you ever notice your emotional circuitry getting engaged in a meeting. One thing that you could do to condition yourself to be able to catch yourself when that happens is practice mindfulness. And you can do that these days with a lot of apps or a YouTube course. When prioritizing your calendar, recognize that time will always be your most precious and perishable resource. If you have a task that you don't enjoy doing, you know, the amazing thing about the world today is that you can delegate that, and you can not just reclaim your time, but every activity that you personally don't enjoy doing, there is somebody that would love to do it, and they'd love to do it all day. And because they enjoy it, and because they enjoy it so much, they'll probably be better than you at it. So likewise, you need to make sure that you reciprocate. And when somebody gives you a task that you love, you make sure that that value exchange is there, so that anybody that you're spending that's spending time on helping you do the things that you don't want to do is also benefiting from not having to do the things that they don't want to do. Learning from the best, dead or alive. If somebody accomplished something that you admire, study them. Learn, and I highly encourage you to do that by reading what they wrote and not what others wrote about them, if possible. Wherever possible, listen to their speeches, take apart their winning patterns, find the things that they do that you can borrow, or use their achievements as inspiration. Remember that up until the moment that somebody realizes their dreams, what they're talking about is considered crazy. And then try to pay attention to the journey that these remarkable people have taken, because success leaves a lot of clues behind. And I'm personally very grateful to now have mentors that were previously my heroes. And that's my dream for all of my friends. And that's something that I hope for everybody listening in today. It's an incredible sensation to have your heroes turn into your mentors and friends. And you start to learn and grow a lot faster. And lastly, be a rebel and don't be a jerk. I believe that one of the greatest disservices that the Steve Jobs folklore is that it has given some people the impression that they should be mean at work. And that's just wrong. It's the wrong focus, and it's not accurate. People should instead be asking, how did Steve Jobs inspire so many extraordinary innovations? How did he hire? How did he cast such incredible teams? Why did they keep coming? Why did they keep coming to work? How did these people stay motivated? And why did they follow him for so long? Empathy is really, really important. And it's not as in vogue to talk about being lovable and being kind. But if you are lovable and kind, you will be loved. Treat people nicely and they will reciprocate and treat you nicely. And it's just a much more pleasant way to go through the journey. Really hope that you all have an incredible journey ahead, and hope that this helps to energize you to realize your own full potential. And with that, I want to say thank you so much and happy to take questions.
Well, Leerom, that was wonderful. Thank you again. I mean, thank you for this view of a hugely successful organization and how it got there. You know, some really amazing points on the importance of people and the alignment of people and organization, how to think in a contemporary way about the relationship between a successful organization, how it strategizes and this contemporary environment that we're in. And then some just at the end, this great, tremendous personal advice for us in our professional lives. So thank you. I mean, like this morning, we had some really great questions come in, and I'm happy to share a couple of them with you. The first one is, so clearly you've managed tremendous growth. And so the question was, what can companies do to ensure that new talent joins their team? So it says, for example, student internships, recent graduates, et cetera. So yeah, so glad to take your thoughts on that.
Sure. Well, first of all, what I would say is that it's a lot harder to scale an organization that's compounding at 40% per year than 4% per year. You know, people will naturally be able to keep up with an organization that's growing 2 or 3% per year. But there's a different problem that growing at 2, 3, 4% per year creates. And that is that if you think about what people are intrinsically motivated by, there is high order things like mastery, purpose, autonomy, and people like Dan Pink have written beautifully about that. But on a day-to-day basis, it's who I get to work with. Am I getting enough change? Am I getting enough challenge? Am I getting enough learning? And growth is actually the fuel for opportunity. So if you hire really remarkable individuals, those individuals will want those promotion opportunities. They'll want those stretch goals, and growth actually creates an abundance of that. And the benefits that accrue from that, I think, are very healthy for a culture. In that you're not seeing the person beside you as competition, you're seeing the marketplace as the competitor, and that could be incredibly energizing. The flip side of that is that if you're going to grow at that compounded rate, you need a lot of infrastructure to develop people at that rate so that they can keep pace with the organization. And that's why, you know, at Klick, personally, I spend about 80% of my time focused on that, and I'm not even client visible. In terms of how we continue to scale that, this year we'll see about 70,000 candidates. So it's hard to join Klick to hire about 600 individuals. But we do have a very robust internship program. We just added a cohort of 50 or so interns. We're going to be adding another one later this year. You can see we're very transparent about our culture and the opportunities. I'll shamelessly plug careers.click.com if you want to learn more.
Wonderful. No, thank you. A general question came in, and I think that sort of you've shared you know your growth journey with the organization, but you know given that the world continues to change, I guess this is a single one. What would be your biggest piece of advice to a young aspiring business person? So let's call that an entrepreneur. So someone is starting trying to start you know that Klick in 2021. You know how do you guide them?
Well, I think the single most important thing is making sure that you find something that you truly love, and you know whether it's a frustration because you see something that you think could be done better, whether it's an injustice that you want to fix, you need a problem that you really believe in and energizes you. And more than anything, take action. And action could literally be read every book you can find on the subject, watch interviews with people you respect on the subject, and build a mental map for what's happening in the space that you want to attack. The world doesn't need more Me Too companies. The world needs truly modern and new ideas to solve the big problems that that we collectively face as a society. And I think understanding the role that technology can play in that is really, really important. So specifically, I would recommend that anybody that's thinking of starting a business today, learn everything that they can about exponentials. There's a ton of great books on exponential technology. If I were to recommend one off the top of my head, it would be Platform Scale. And just understand how these markets work and how these forces, how things like network effects and long tail and all of these forces that have been really well studied by academia, understand how they work and how they can act as superpowers to really provide your business with tailwinds. And then the last, I'll give you two more last pieces of advice on this, but do this with people you like too. Business is a team sport, and you can't do anything on your own. I'm blessed to be surrounded by people that are a lot smarter and more experienced than myself. But it takes courage, especially when you're starting out, to hire people that intimidate you, but you won't grow, certainly not at your maximum potential, if you're not surrounded by wonderful individuals. And build in practices for challenging in a way that's constructive. I'll give you two pieces of advice there. A wonderful book, probably the book that's influenced me in business more than any other, is A Conscious Business by Fred Kaufman. Just a wonderful read on how to navigate this many situations that you will encounter in the workplace, and I guarantee you will. And you know, for Aaron and I, one of the most important things, with the benefit of hindsight, we didn't know that this was an important practice, but with the benefit of hindsight, we created this practice that we called Switch, and Aaron could say it or I could say it at any given point. And immediately we had to, now if our emotional circuitry is engaged, maybe we take a 5-minute timeout, go for a walk, get a coffee. But when we come back, we have to take the opposite position. And suddenly all those questions that you were hoping that wouldn't be thrown your way, you have to throw them. And if you honor that and you do that with integrity, then you are going to arrive at better answers. And you'll be surprised at how many times you'll convince yourself that maybe what you were thinking was incorrect. And that's very healthy, because you're much better off taking a swing and a miss in the context of a discussion than actually leaning in and trying to brute force something.
Okay. Well, no, great. And I'm glad that there was two last pieces of advice there. You know, interesting question here about, you know, the times, you know, that we find ourselves in with, you know, COVID and the growth of companies. And, you know, we just came from a session on well-being. So how has Klick, or how, what's your view on sort of reconciling the importance of growth and competitiveness, and then on the importance of over delivering with personal well-being and work-life balances?
So I want to qualify this by saying I think COVID does make everything harder, and from a leadership point of view, empathy and safety for the team obviously have to come first. And empathy doesn't just necessarily mean a health condition. It could be stress and the environment that we're all in. You know, we're as a society going through a lot right now. You know, it's not just the pandemic. There's been a really important social justice movement happening in all around the world these days. There's also a lot of things happening with anti-racism. Each one of these things creates a lot of tension, and you know, some of this tension is great because I think we're seeing progress in society. But you know, it was too much of a nail biter, in my opinion, watching the political landscape in the last election, and it's very scary for people. And so, I guess that's a really long way of saying that you have to be especially attuned to mental health and not just physical health in this time. Zoom fatigue is real, and it's just harder to lead when you can't go for a walk or a coffee or a lunch or do a workshop in person. All of these things are a lot harder. And so I guess empathy would be at the top, and creativity. We've had to refactor everything that we do. You know, one of our biggest parties every year, and parties are a big part of the Klick culture. One of our biggest parties is Halloween, and we have to figure out how to do Halloween at home. And we had to figure out how to support people when their kids were sent home from school. And each one of these things becomes a problem statement. And you got to make sure that you define that problem statement properly, and then figure out what you can do to offset the additional stress that's been created by this pandemic. You know, I love to read, and I love to read about history, and I love to read about pivotal moments in history. Experiencing them in real time, these pivotal moments of history in real time, not as much fun. But you know, none of us have a playbook for this, and all of us need to adapt. With all of that said, I want to push back on the premise of the question, which is that growth and fulfillment are at odds. And I think it's actually the opposite. Growth can drive you to be learning at a faster rate. Growth can drive you to be enjoying what you do more, to get more change and more variety in what you do. So growth in and of itself isn't necessarily bad. What you need is that growth to be tempered or metered with workload being manageable, and that's the hard part, because you know, nothing we do in business is a perfect science, and we're all humans, and as fellow earthlings, leadership is messy, and it's particularly hard when you don't have all of your tools available to you, and we don't. We're disembodied and two-dimensional on Zoom right now. It's not the same as an in-person meeting, but do the best that you can. Continue to adapt and check in and listen. I find that I spend a lot more time listening than I used to, and I do so because I feel like I need to, and I hope that all the leaders at Klick are taking the time to spend more time and listen and check in with people on how things are going at home.
Wonderful. No, that's great. Leerom, I'd like to thank you again. The students are about to go into their breakout rooms. You know, on again, it's, you know, such a cohesive talk, you know, from the, you know, personal to the professional, and then, you know, organizational, really like so instructive and really very helpful. And I'm sure this, I mean, I've gotten so much out of this personally. You know, and I'm sure the students are so appreciative as well. So on behalf of the whole team here, thank you for your time. You know,
thank you so much.
Valuable. You know, again, it's been great to have you. So thank you. We look forward to, you know, hopefully speaking again